And today we are going to complete two very interesting members of Monocots. And the first family which we are going to study today is the family Apogonocetaceae. Very interestingly, this family has also been recorded from Kas Pathar. So it is very close to us. And Apogonocetaceae sayadrica was the species which was reported from Kas Pathar. It's an aquatic plant. And on your screen, you can see the details. Apogonocetaceae, as I told you, it is an offshoot. The family has been separated from Heterocaryticae and it has been raised to a level of a separate family. Now, it's a very small family of tropics and subtropics. So, it is limited. Especially, the family is restricted to the old world. And obviously, in Africa, in Asia, in Australia, these members are reported. So it's a monogenic family, a single genus Apogonocetaceae, and it is having almost 47 species. The plants are aquatic, obviously. All the plants, they are freshwater plants. They are not marine water plants at all. But also, these plants, they are found in a stagnant water body, not in running water body. So the plants are perennial because they are having a perennial root stock or a stem stock. They are herbaceous with the presence of laticiferous ducts in the stem. So laticiferous ducts are present, and these laticiferous ducts, it contains a milky latex. It's a very interesting character that the stem is containing milky latex. Also, obviously, the stem is covered with the scaly nodes. The stem is a corm or it is a rhizomatous. Obviously, it is perennial with the scales which are present, and it is deeply rooted in the substratum of the water body. Now, the leaves are stipulate, and these leaves, they generally float on the surface of the water body. So, they are having a long petiole, and they are having a sheathing leaf base. The leaves are always ovate or lanceolate. They are also called as emergent leaves. That is, some part of the leaf, they may be submerged in the water, and remaining part of the water body, remaining part of the leaf, it may be floating on the surface. So the leaves are either emergent or they are freely floating. So they are coming on the surface. Obviously, they are having a parallel close venation. That is also a very interesting character. So it is not a parallel, but it is a parallel close venation. The plants, they do have the inflorescence. The inflorescence is one-sided. It is having 1, 2, 3 flowered spikes which are borne on a spathe, a leafy bract. And always the flowers, they come up above the water body. So the flowers are present in the air, or the inflorescence is present in the air. And the leaves are present. They are freely floating on the water body, and the stem is submerged. As far as the flowers are concerned, the flowers are bracteate. They are having a very conspicuous bract, which is almost spathaceous. It is green. It is boat shaped. The flowers are zygomorphic. Now, this is because of the typical odd irregular shape of the perianth. And because of the flowers are zygomorphic, they are trimerous. Obviously, there is no any distinction between the calyx and corolla. And because of that, the flowers are incomplete. The floral parts are cyclic. Obviously, the flowers are not pedicellate, but the flowers are sessile. So they are without stalks and they are hypogynous. Now, generally, the flowers are not that way small. It is much larger in size. But even though it cannot be called as a conspicuous flower, so we can call them as an inconspicuous flower. So as far as the perianth is concerned, the perianth lobe, they are 2 to 6. Usually, they are 3. Or 3+3. These lobes are free. They are present in 2 holes. They are highly zygomorphic. They are petaloid. Usually they are white in color, or we can find even the pink or red color. They are single walled sometimes when they are showing a valvate distribution. So either it may be in the two whorls as a calyx and corolla, that is the outer whorl and inner whorl, or otherwise if they may be present in the single whorl. In some species, even the perianth is absent. Now this is the image of the apomageton. You can see the floating leaves. They are typically ovate shaped, and the inflorescence is coming up in the air, and it is directly exposed to the air. So you can see the very dark colored stamens and the flowers which are arranged on a one axis. So they are monoaxial, and you can see the bracts which are large and spathiceous. So this is sort of a close up of these two. Now the right figure, which is seen, this is the plant of Apomageton cyathrica, which has been reported from the Khas. And the other members, they are present in the elsewhere, particularly in the Himalayan range as well as in South India. So Apomageton is having a bimerous arrangement. So they are present on two stalks, and that's why it's a separate genera. Even also in left side, you can see the two stalks which are coming up. They are having a bright perianth lobes, and they are showing the presence of stamens. Now this is a diagram of Apomageton. It is a dischicus because the leaves are present in two forms, and you can see the image of the flower at the bottom. So it is the anther of the flower. Obviously, it is the female component which is showing the unilocular ovary with the two ovules at the base. And then you can see a single flower in closed form, and you can see the inflorescence at the center. Now this is a sketch of the Apomageton. Now this Apomageton has been reported from Indonesia, and so this is a typical sketch of Apomageton, again which is showing the inflorescence, which is a diagonal inflorescence, that is in two parts, and they are having a petaloid bracts and with the stamens at the base. Now, as per the Apomageton is concerned, the plants are having the stamens. They are 3+3, or many of the times the stamens are much more, many. Even though number may be 18 or 36, the stamens are free. Generally, they are present in many whorls, outer whorl, inner whorl. They are diplostaminous, that is, stamens are branched. And you can see the branching is deeply rooted, so it is deeply curved, and so right from the base the filaments are branched. Obviously the stamens are extrose, they are opening outside. The anthers are dithicus, they are in two capsules, two walls, and they are dehiscing longitudinally. As far as the ovary is concerned, ovary is 3 to 6 carpellary. Basically they are tricarpellary syncarpus, they are tricarpellary apocarpus. The ovaries, they are free, they are superior with unilocular ovary. So each carpel is separate, and they are generally containing more than one ovule. So the ovule number is much more larger than one. And very interestingly, here the placenta, the base of the ovule, is elongated, and on this elongated placenta the ovules are placed. So even though it may look like a marginal placentation, but basically from morphological and developmental point of view, this particular family, it contains a basal placenta. So the ovule, unilocular ovary with one to many ovules which are present on a basal placenta. Obviously the style is very short, and it is having a capitate stigma. As the flowers are coming up in the air, the pollination is obviously because of the insects. So it is entomophilous. So the fruit is an aggregate, because I told you it is the whole inflorescence is getting converted into a fruit. And also, as the ovaries are free, the flower, obviously the fruit becomes an aggregate fruit. It is a dehiscent capsule, it is a dehiscent follicle. So it is a fleshy, and that's why it's a follicle, and the seeds are non-endospermic. It's a very interesting family. So as it is having the many free stamens which are branched in many whorls, it is having the many carpels which are free. They are having a unilocular ovule, but many again ovules which are present on the basal placenta. Again, the abscess of the perianth as such and enlarged fleshy petaloid bract or spathe, also the aquatic habitat, all these characters, they indicate the close relationship of this family towards the Alismataceae. So it is very closely associated with the Alismataceae. So this genus initially it was included in the Hadrocharidaceae because the tricarpellar is in carpus ovary with the superior nature. But later on, this because of the apocarpus nature, this particular Aponogeton genus has been separated from the Hadrocharidaceae, and this has been raised at the level as a separate family. So it's a very unique family. It's a very interesting family. But at the same time, it is showing a reduction in the perianth loop, and the perianth itself is highly zygomorphic. Also, the aqueous habitat has been acquired by this plant. Basically, these plants are terrestrial, but slowly they have acquired the aqueous habitat, and because of that, they are reflecting a progressive advanced evolution. And because of that, these are leading to the complexity. So even though this family on one side, it is compared with the Alismataceae, obviously we do know that the Alismataceae is compared with the Ranunculaceae, and Ranunculaceae ultimately is nothing but it's an offshoot of Magnoliaceae. Magnoliaceae are the tree plants and Ranunculaceae are the herbaceous plants. Obviously in the Magnoliaceae, there are many ovules which are apocarpus condition, which are free. In Ranunculaceae, there are many ovules which are superior, which are free. Again, in Alismataceae, there are ovules which are many and free. And then in this genus, Aponogetonaceae, again, the ovules are many, they are free, and they are unilocular with the many ovules on marginal placenta. Now, because of all these characters, on one side, this family is having a very clear-cut, close relationship with that of the primitive characters, which are tending towards or which are pointing towards the characters of Alismataceae on one side and the aquatic dicot Reynolds group, especially the Nymphaeaceae group and the Ranunculaceae group. And because of that, the Aponogetonaceae is on one side, is showing a very distinct closeness, close affinity with the herbaceous Ranunculaceae group and Alismataceae group because of the aqueous habitat. And at the same time, the plant itself is exhibiting the zygomorphic character. It is showing the reduction in the characters. It is showing again the advancement in the habitat, because the stem is present, which is underground, the water body, whereas it is having a sheathing leaf base, which is having the elongated petiole, and also the lamina is freely floating on the water body surface. And because of that, it clearly indicates that the aquatic habitat of this Aponogeton, it has been an adapted character. It is an ecologically adapted character. And because of that, on the other hand, the Aponogetonaceae is treated as an advanced family among the monocotyledons. So even though it is showing the close relationship with the family Alismataceae on one side, this family is very distinct, separate, and highly evolved family than Alismataceae. So as far as when we are concerned with the Hadrocharidaceae and Aponogetonaceae, and when we compare these two families with the Alismataceae, there is one distinctness. The distinctness is that in Alismataceae, the basic character of the habitat itself is an aquatic habitat. And this trend has come up from the aqueous Ranunculaceae group, especially from the Nymphaeaceae members. So in Nymphaeaceae members also, we will find the lamellar stamens. In Alismataceae also, we will find the lamellar stamens, which are free and there are many. And because of that, Ranunculaceae and Alismataceae, they are really from Hadrocharidaceae and Aponogetonaceae. These two families, even though they are having or they are showing the aquatic habitat, and even though they are showing the many reproductive parts like stamens and carpels, even the carpels are free, stamens are also free, it from anatomical point of view or from internal morphological point of view, Aponogetonaceae and Hadrocharidaceae, they clearly indicate that basically they are modified for the aquatic habitat. They are altered for the aquatic habitat. So initially the plants were exhibiting a typical terrestrial habitat, and slowly, because of the ecological advantage, these members, they have shifted themselves to the aquatic habitat. Again, there is a difference between the aponogeneity and heterocharitacy. That in a heterocharitacy is much more advanced than aponogeneity, because heterocharitacy members, they are not only acquiring the aquatic habitat of the freshwater body, but they are present in almost large number of range. So on the contrary, they are present in the stagnant water body, they are present in the running water body, and also on other side, they are present in the brackish water, or they are present on the seashore. That is the marine forms. So heterocharitacy, as far as the habitat is concerned, ecological advantage is concerned, it is much more widespread, and because of the heterocharitacy family is that way a cosmopolitan family. On the contrary, when we talk about the aponogeneity, it is not a cosmopolitan family. It is a restricted family, and these are restricted towards the old world, especially from the Africa, Asia, and Australia. And because of that, the aponogeneity is a unique family as far as the hydrocharitis is concerned. And because of these specific characters, this family has been separated from hydrocharitis, and the aponogeton has been raised at the aponogeneity family. Now, when we are discussing this, we are supposed to compare the aponogeneity with one more genera, which is equally interesting. And then another family, which we are going to study, is the family Najadaceae. So Najadaceae is again a family which has been separated from Heterocharitaceae. And the genus is Najas. Now, this Najas genus is almost an offshoot of Heterocharitaceae, but this genus itself is a cosmopolitan. So the members of this genus, they are found in almost all five continents, and they are present in all habitats. That is, they are present in the New World as well as they are present in the Old World. So it's a cosmopolitan family, and the members are reported right from the temperate zone, that is beyond 45 degrees Cape of Capricorn, to the tropical belt, that is towards the equator. So in all five continents, in the freshwater body, these members are found. So this is again a genus monogeneric, a single genus Najas, which is having almost 50 species, which are spread almost all over the world. They are distributed with a wide area. So they are present in the colder regions, they are present in the subtropical region, and also they have been reported in the tropical belt. So these members, they are spread over a wide range of ecological habitat. The plants are aquatic, obviously they are herbs. Now in Najas genus, many of the species, they are herbaceous and annual. So they do not have the perennial rootstock or perennial stem. On the contrary, they are growing from the seeds. And because of that, these plants are aquatic herbs. They are showing the stem, which may be showing the presence of nodes and internodes. Or very rarely, in some genera, the stem may be present in the form of a corm or a bulb, and then the plant becomes a perennial one. So generally, Najas genus is an annual herb, aquatic, freshwater, green, herbaceous, as well as sometimes it may be perennial. So the stem is present either in the form of a showing the nodes and internodes, or it may be showing in the presence of a corm at the base or a bulb from which the offshoots of aerial part or the shoot part, they come up. Now, as far as the Najas genus is concerned, the leaves are stipulate. Now, remember, in aponogeneity, the laticiferous ducts were present in the stem. Whereas in this case, such a type of laticiferous ducts are totally absent. So the leaves are present, which are stipulate, they are simple, they are sessile without any petiole, but they are having a sheathing leaf base, which is much more elongated and longer. So the leaves, generally, they are opposite or whorled. So the lamina is entire, with a very prominent midvein. Generally, the leaves are always submerged, but very rarely they may come up on the surface and they are freely floating. There is one more difference as far as the Najanisee and Apuna Jetanisee is concerned. In Apuna Jetanisee, the leaf lamina is much more obovate in shape. It is glabrous and it is having a prominent petiole. In this case, in Najer's genus, the lamina, even though it is entire, it is very much shorter, small, and it is submerged. It is not free floating, but very interestingly, it is having one character that the margins of this Najer's genus, they are serrate or dentate, whereas in Apuna Jetanisee, the leaf lamina is always smooth and it is not having any appendages at all. As far as the inflorescence is concerned, the flowers are solitary, axillary, or there may be few flower cymes which are born in the axils. Generally, the flowers are born in the spathiceous bract and they are having two bilipped involucres. So the bracts are present in the form of two pairs, or it is not two pairs, it's one pair. The bracts are present in a single pair, and in that involucre of bract, the flowers are born. Generally, the flowers are unisexual in Najanisee, whereas the flowers are bisexual in Apuna Jetanisee. The plants may be mono or dioecious. So obviously, they may be born on the same plant or separate plants. Obviously, the flowers are incomplete because there is no presence of perianth. The perianth is totally absent. The flowers are zygomorphic because of the odd arrangement of the bracts. And obviously, the flowers are trimerous, sessile, without any pedicel. They are very minute. So even though male and female flowers are concerned, the flowers are very minute. The flowers are hypogynous, similar to the Hydrocharitaceae and Apuna Jetanisee. And obviously, the floral whorls are cyclic in arrangement. So there is no any spiral arrangement. So Najanisee family is an advanced family that way. So the perianth is absent. Sometimes in case of male flowers in some species, the scales may be present. And the scales may be sepaloid, they are green color. Generally the male flowers show the presence of sepals, presence of perianth, which are a single whorled. Now this is the genus Najas. You might have seen this plant because this plant is reported from the Konkan in India. This plant is reported from the South India. The plant is reported from the Bengal. The plant is present in the Andhra Pradesh. Even the plant is present up to the basin of Ganga, that is Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. But this plant is not found beyond Khasi Hills or at 4,000 meters height of the Himalayan range. So these plants, they're aquatic. They are covering the water body. Some parts of this, you can see the image, some part of the vegetation is freely floating on the air in the water body, whereas the remaining part is submerged. Then at the bottom, you can see at the right hand corner, the image of a single twig. And this image is showing a female flower. You can see in the axil, there is a pair of bracts which are containing a single ovule at the center. So this is an image of Najas genus. And if you see in a close pattern, this is a Najas genus, which is showing a dicotyl arrangement of the growth. So the growth is dichotomous. Now this plant is very similar to that of Vallisneria and Ceratophyllum, because we are having one genus which is close to the Najas, and that genus is Ceratophyllum. The Ceratophyllum leaves are also very similar to that of Najas. Now you can see the dentate arrangement of the leaves on the left sketch, whereas in the right sketch it is another species. It is a Flexis. And this is a main axis of Najas genus. Now you can see the female flower in the axil of the bracts. You can see the right image at the bottom. There's a female flower that in the pair of involucre of bracts, the two flowers are present. Each flower is having the superior ovary with a single style and a quadrified or tetraphyllid stigma. Similarly, in this image, on the left side, you can see the male flower as well as you can see the female flower separately. So this is the genus Narcissus. This is a sketch, and the sketch is showing the fruit at the bottom. You can see the sheathing leaf base because there is a sketch of leaf also along with this twig. Now, as far as the Narcissus is concerned, reproductive characters are concerned, in the female flowers, it is very interestingly, the stamen is always a single stamen is present. The stamen is always one with the sessile unilocular anthers. So anther is not dithecous, it is a monothecous, it is singling, containing the unithecous anthers and dehiscing irregularly because it is splitting, it is opening up. It is extrose and exerted. Obviously, because of that, there is no perineum, the stamens are coming up of the flower tube, bracteate tube, or it can be called as the involucre. So as far as the male flowers are concerned, they are having a pair of bracts, which is called the involucre, and then it is containing a single stamen. Now, we can compare this particular male flower to the character of the male flower in family Casuarinaceae. In Casuarinaceae also, the male flowers are born in the axil. They are having a pair of bracts. The perianth is totally absent or scaly. And the male flower, it contains or it is represented by a single stamen. In Casuarinaceae also, the stamens are present, which is having a single anther. So it is unilocular, or it is called a monothecous, and also it is dehiscing. Now, in case of Casuarinaceae, it is dehiscing longitudinally. In this case, it is dehiscing irregularly. The difference is that in Casuarinaceae, the male flowers are born in the air. In Narcissus, the male flowers are born in the water body. So, Casuarinaceae genus is a terrestrial form. Narcissus members are aquatic forms. Because of that, in the male flower, a single stamen is present. Similarly, in the female flower, the ovary is monocarpellary. It contains a single carpel. Unilocular, it is having a single locule with a single ovule on basal placenta. So this is a very unique character, which is showing a very close affinity to that of the ranunculus, as well as to the Magnulus group. Or on the other hand, we can say it is showing a close affinity toward the Reynolds group of dicots. The style is filiform, it is very short, and the stigma is either capitate or it is trilobed, three-lobed. The fruit is a dry, indehiscent achene, so it is a hard nut. The seeds are non-endospermic. Generally, the seeds are starchy, and as it belongs to the monocotyledons, it contains a single cotyledon. This family, as per the phylogenetic significance is concerned, this family is treated as an offshoot of the family Hydro. And the carpels are single. Here also the carpels are single. So there also we can find a single stamen. In this family also we can find a single stamen. And because of that, Hydrocharitaceae is considered as the genus which was initially placed in Hydrocharitaceae, but later on it has been separated and placed at the higher level of the order of taxonomic level, and that is a genus at the family level, Narcissus. So the simple stamens and simple carpel, absence of perianth, it shows a very clear-cut affinity, close affinity towards the Alismataceae. And because of that, the Narcissus and Apologetonaceae, both these families, they bear a unique position among the monocots. Now, as the Hydrocharitaceae as well as Narcissus both show that they have acquired the aquatic habitat. So by nature, through evolution, they are not aquatic, but they have acquired the aquatic habitat. And because of that, the Narcissus family is considered as one of the advanced family of monocots. And the simplicity in the floral character, absence of the perianth, reduction in the floral characters, single stamen and single carpel, it has been considered that this particular unique position of simplicity, it has been acquired because of the reduction in evolution or reduction through the progressive evolution. So here in Narcissus, we can find or we can trace The evolutionary progress, evolutionary complexity, and this evolutionary complexity has ultimately resulted in the simplification of the vegetative characters as well as reproductive characters. And because of that, even though Nazareci is exhibiting very simple characters at the vegetative level as well as at the reproductive level, because the flowers are unisexual, male flower is represented by the pair of bracts and a single stamen, whereas the female flower is represented by a pair of bracts in the involucre and a single carpel with a single ovule on basal placenta. This is an acquired character, because from evolutionary point of view and from anatomical point of view, Nazareci family shows the occurrence of trimerous ovule, but other two ovaries, they are suppressed, and one ovary, it becomes functional. But because of that, it can be traced as a trace in developmental biology. But because of that, the Nazareci is considered as a successful aquatic family, which is showing the unique characters in the course of evolution. And because of that, Aponogeatronaceae as well as Nazareci, they have been placed as an advanced monocots, whereas the Alismataceae has been placed as a primitive monocot. Now, when we have compared these two families or these two genera, on one side we have studied the Aponogeton, and on another side we have studied the Nazareci. The Aponogeton is having the many stamens and many carpels and free nature, whereas in Nazareci we are finding a single stamen and a single carpel. All these, they have been separated from the Heterocharidaceae, and because of that, the four families of the monocots which we have studied, the family Alismataceae, the family Heterocharidaceae, the family Aponogeatronaceae, and today's family Nazareci, all are having or all are bearing a unique position from phylogenetic point of view. And because of that, these families are to be studied very extensively, very deeply, and they are to be compared with the other families, other order, other series, and the other trends of evolutionary progress which has been taken up in angiosperms. So with this, we have completed the two genera today. One genera was Aponogeatron, and here I am showing the images again of Nazareci genus, which is an aquatic plant. So this is the Nazareci genus, and I will show you the Aponogeatron also. So this is the Aponogeatron. So these two genera, they have been separated from Heterocharidaceae. We have studied the Heterocharidaceae also before. So with this discussion, I'm very much happy that because of your very strong cooperation and positiveness, we have completed all the families which were supposed to be studied under the topic of angiosperms. So we started with the family Magnoliaceae. Then we have studied the family Nymphaeaceae, another family which we have studied. So these two families, they belong to the order Renales of Diatomaceous, which were from the obviously tree habit and aqueous habitat. Then we started our discussion with the Amentiferae group, which was identified by the Eichler, and then which was promoted by the Enger and Prandtl, and later it was followed by the Melchior and many others. So in Amentiferae, we have studied several members which were initially placed by the Bentham and Hooker in the unisexuals, and then by core angiosperm by other workers like Stewart and Taftajan and Cronquist and many others. So then we studied from Amentiferae, we have studied the family Cajoranaceae, we have studied the family Urticaceae, we have studied the family Moraceae. Then we have studied the family Piperaceae, and then we have studied the family Lauraceae. Lastly, we have studied a very unique family, and that was the family Aristolochiaceae. We have studied the five families, totally six families from the Amentiferi group. One was the Casuarinaceae, another was the Moraceae, third was the Urticaceae, the fourth family was Piperaceae, the genus Piper, and the sixth family, which are the fifth family we have studied, is the family Lauraceae, where we have studied the genus Cinnamon, and then we have studied the family Aristolochiaceae, which is having the six genera, which are represented in India. And Aristolochia is a very common genus, which is having a very complex zygomorphic single walled perianth. And then we have studied the four families from the monocots. The first family we have studied was the aquatic. All these four families are aquatic ones. And the first family which we have studied was the Alismataceae. Then we have studied the family Hydrocharitaceae. And today we have studied the two monogenic families. One was the Aponogetonaceae and another is the family Nazadaceae. And with this, we have completed a comparative survey and phylogenetic relationship of the Renales group on one side, the Amentiferi group on the other side, and the primitive dicots and primitive monocots and their correlation with each other. When we have discussed, we have studied their correlation from the vegetative point of view, from the habitat point of view, from the geological and geographical distribution point of view. We have studied from the anatomical details, anatomical specializations, and then we have studied the progressive evolution among the floral components or the floral parts. And in this way, we have studied these families. Now, today I am going to give you a task. Now, you are supposed to submit. Obviously, you have to take more than 4 to 5 days, and on coming Monday and Tuesday, all of you are supposed to submit in writing the distinguishing characters of each and every family, the systematic position of each and every family, the systematic position as per as the Bentham-Hooker system of classification is concerned, and then you have to prepare a sort of a flow chart or diagram, a comparative chart of all these families together. Also, you have to submit the floral diagram and floral formula of these all families. So for each family, you have to submit its habitat, its distinguishing characters, its floral formula, its floral diagram, and its comparative account. That is the flow chart or comparative chart at the end. So this is the task as an assessment for each one of you, and you are supposed to submit this independently. But for that purpose, you can follow the books which are available. You can follow the book of Singh. You can follow the book of Kapoor. You can follow the book of Vashistha. Even you can follow the book of Mandal. You can follow the book of Gupta. Gupta and Singh, that is the Angiosperm taxonomy, and you have to prepare this, and you are supposed to submit all these assessments on the WhatsApp group which the Patil madam has created. So submit all the documents to Patil ma'am. She will be handing over these documents to me, and then I'll be assessing this, and accordingly this will be the first assessment as far as the taxonomy is concerned. So with this, today we will be having a break at the moment. So I will close this and open a chat box for discussion. If you are having any queries, just open up your